For more than a decade, Fran Pavley was Sacramento's go-to woman on legislation addressing climate change, energy, and the environment. During her 14 years as a legislator, Senator Pavley authored three major climate change bills to reduce greenhouse gas emissions in California. Senator Pavley's entry into politics began in 1982. I love this story. I remember this. You told me this story the first time I was in your office. And I thought, this is an example of citizenship. She'd been teaching middle school for 29 years at the time and getting more and more concerned about public issues. And so here's what happened. She was teaching at the Chaparral Middle School in Moore Park and living in unincorporated Agora Hills. She got involved in her town's cityhood campaign at the urging of friends and decided to run for city council. Not only did she win, but she became the newly incorporated city's first mayor. Because most of her time with the city involved making decisions on land use, she went back to school for her master's degree in environmental planning. The degree helped pave the way for appointments with the Santa Monica Mountains Conservancy Advisory Committee and the California Coastal Commission. After four terms on the Agora Hills City Council, she ran for the State Assembly, winning a seat in 2000. During her first term in office, Senator Pavley formed a coalition of environmentalists, medical groups, entrepreneurs, and religious leaders to pass her first major legislation, the Clean Cars Law, which required a reduction in greenhouse gas emissions from vehicle tailpipes. Her bill, Assembly Bill 1493, was signed by Governor Gray Davis in 2002. In 2009, President Obama announced new rules to cut greenhouse gas emissions from cars nationwide, one of his administration's first big steps to fight climate change. These emissions standards were based on Senator Pavley's 2002 law. Obama's 2009 embrace of her car emissions standards was preceded by years of courtroom battles with the auto industry. But after Obama negotiated a deal with them to apply the rules nationwide, those same car companies eventually came to view Senator Pavley as a partner on such issues as promoting electric vehicles and fuel cell cars. Get this. This is remarkable. In 2013, she received a Legislator of the Year award from the Alliance of Automobile Manufacturers, one of the trade groups that sued to block her law. The standards are Pavley's biggest legacy outside of California. Even if Trump were to remove the federal auto standards, he would not be able to undo the 2002 California law, which remains in place. Canada adopted the same greenhouse gas and mileage standards after Obama did. So if Trump undid her legacy, the car makers would be back where they started, facing different standards in different places. Senator Pavley's next big piece of legislation in the Assembly was the landmark 2006 California Global Warming Solutions Act, AB 32, which committed California to reduce its greenhouse gas emissions to 1990 levels by 2020. Before her Senate term ended in 2016, Senator Pavley teamed with Senate President Pro Tem Kevin DeLeon and Assemblyman Eduardo Garcia to pass a pair of related climate laws. One, SB 32, the sequel to AB 32, requires the state to cut greenhouse gas emissions to 40% below 1990 levels by 2030. The other, AB 197, gives the legislature more oversight of the state's air pollution regulators and priorities emissions cuts from industrial facilities that are often located in poor communities burdened with pollution. Now, if that's not enough, some of Senator Pavley's other legislative victories in the Senate included authoring laws establishing California's first statewide regulation of groundwater basins, stiffening penalties for mortgage fraud, banning lead and cadmium in children's jewelry, implementing California's first regulations for oil and gas well stimulation techniques like fracking and acidizing, and setting new safety standards for gas storage wells in response to the massive gas leak at Aliso Canyon in her district. So to summarize, middle school teacher, 29 years, mayor for four terms, coastal commissioner for about 6 years, member of the Santa Monica Mountain Conservancy Advisory Committee and president of the LA Division of the League of California Cities in 1996, California Assembly, three terms, member of the Assembly Committees on Education, Budget, Transportation, Water, Parks, and Wildlife, chair of the Budget Committee on Resources, two terms in the Senate, and in the Senate, member of the Senate Committee on Health, Energy, Utilities, and Communications, Transportation, and Housing, as well as Environmental Quality. And then she termed out in 2016. She was chair of the Natural Resources and Water Committees and chair of the Select Committee on Climate Change and AB 32 Implementation and Autism. That is quite a career. And so you are an example of the kind of inspiration we hope is engendered in this room. So.
I live in Agora Hills, and if anyone knows where that is, it's about at Ventura County. If you know anything about the 101 and the 405, the only pause I had was, do I have enough hours left of my life to make it down there and back? So I convinced my husband that he would love to spend the night close by, and he was my chauffeur along the way, and so we survived because we sort of dodged the peak traffic time. So that's why I'm here, and I'm glad to be here. And you'd think someone who was involved in climate change policies wouldn't choose to drive 150 miles spewing emissions from their cars down the freeways, but we're still working on options here. We didn't have a lot of them, so thank you. Thank you very much for the kind invitation. And in California, we have 40 million people. That's more than all of Canada. Canada's 25 million, more of all of Australia. My state Senate district, there's 40 state senators. I represented about a million people. This is way more than someone in member of Congress. And having the fifth biggest economy in the world, we can do amazing things. And I think what the background story of why California is successful is some of our agencies. We have some of the best agencies on the planet, secondly only to probably Washington, D.C., as far as the scope of what they're involved in. Our Air Resources Board that has been around since the 1960s, amazing. Focused primarily on mobile sources, but I made sure in all my legislation that they were the lead agency in implementing all the climate policies. We have, you mentioned the CEC, California Energy Commission. Amazing amount of work done for decades on energy efficiency, primarily, but also low carbon fuels as well. They're there. Top scientists, top engineers, top policy makers, thousands of them who are implementing these laws that don't just happen overnight, but it takes decades. We also have the Public Utilities Commission that's implementing the renewable energy parts of this discussion. So these separate agencies have to work well together. Those in the legislature, my big goal before I left was trying to make sure that those new kids in the legislature understood why these policies passed and they would be the champions of these policies in the future, because otherwise everything we've done is lost. This is too big a challenge. You'll see Jerry Brown, Governor Brown, really sort of ramping up some of his key legacy issues, and one of them is climate change. And we can only hope that the next governor will be as enthusiastic on the topic. So one of my goals as I left office too was to make sure that I helped mentor, if you will, someone that had a chance of becoming my replacement for my Senate district, which allows me to do these kinds of things. And that turned out just fine. This guy named Henry Stern, who just turned 36, it will now be for the next 12 years in the state Senate in California, providing he wins a few more elections. And his main issues and concerns and his priorities really reflect what I've worked on. So I feel very fortunate in that regard. Not like President Obama to have someone follow you that wants to undo everything you've worked on. I feel like I can relax, go to Irvine, take my time on the 405 freeway, and move on. Okay, why are we able to do some of these policies? Well, if you look, we predated the Federal Clean Air Act that passed in Washington, D.C. Our smog was so bad, and it's still bad, but not as bad. The air quality is so poor that we had to start beginning to reduce emissions. I grew up in the San Fernando Valley. I'm a native Angeleno. It was far worse in the 50s than it is now. with less cars. But that was before unleaded gas and catalytic converters and the whole long list of other technologies have been added. So we predated the Federal Clean Air Act, so we have what's called an exemption under the Federal Clean Air Act. California can pass more stringent emission standards than the federal government. That's why we can do what we can do. I guess you have to survive lawsuits and things like that along the way. Also under the Federal Clean Air Act, and it's actually written in the Federal Clean Air Act, so I think the current administration would have to undo that exemption within the Federal Clean Air Act. It gives the option of other states to do one of two things, either adopt California standards or stay with the federal government standards. And our standards, as long as they are more stringent than the federal government standards, usually get implemented. We've had dozens and dozens of exemptions over the last 40, 50 years. They've all been approved, with the exception of one, and that was my tailpipe emission bill. So this is the list of what's been going on the last 30, 40 years. So anything I'm talking about today is built on the good work of people for decades in the past, and for all of you, for decades in the future, right? This is just a transitional period as we're moving forward together, waiting for the United States to take the lead again on this important global policy. And I want to let you know that the states are working together, cities are working together, more behind the scenes, continuing actually to do more than what we thought we were doing a year ago because we need to. So that's been the good news about all this. So that's the whole list of the timeline. The Clean Car Law that you mentioned signed 15 years ago this month. It was the first attempt to regulate greenhouse gas emissions from the tailpipe of automobiles, which we can do under the Federal Clean Air Act. 14 states adopted our standard. The United States Supreme Court, in a decision called Massachusetts versus the Environmental Protection Agency, the EPA at the time, this was the Bush administration days, didn't think they should be able to regulate climate pollution, greenhouse gas emissions, because it wasn't typical of criteria air pollutants. But if you look at the Federal Clean Air Act, they didn't spell each air pollutant. And they made the determination on a 5-4 vote, and that's why Supreme Court appointees matter, on a 5-4 vote that, yes, indeed, this was a form of air pollutant and subject to protection by the Environmental Protection Agency. And that's why the president or the EPA, if they so choose, can move forward in this regard relating to climate change or clean power plans. Unfortunately, when we asked for a waiver under the Federal Clean Air Act, the EPA under the Bush administration denied it in December of 2008, the first waiver ever denied it, even though we had met all the compelling and extraordinary criteria that are listed in the waiver. I took that picture. My background is I'm a middle school teacher and I taught 8th grade American history, taught about the Constitution and how a bill becomes law. I'm in the front row, right in the White House Rose Garden, watching all the CEOs of the foreign and domestic automobile manufacturers who had sued to block my legislation stand with President Obama and announce a sort of a compromise, if you will, marrying California's tailpipe emission standards with the federal government's ability to regulate miles per gallon. They're called the CAFE standards, corporate average fuel efficiency standards, miles per gallon. So all classes of vehicles will have to be operating more efficiently. So let's say you're the owner of Ford Motor Company. You're going to have to reach these targeted reductions, but you can do it with some flexibility. If you own Ford, maybe you have a lot of people who want those big pickup trucks, right? Well, to make up for it, you better be selling a lot of electric cars or fuel efficient cars to balance that. It's a fleet average, right? So that's why you're seeing today, or one of the reasons you're seeing today, all the different foreign and domestic automobile manufacturers producing electric cars or hydrogen cars or other kinds of cars, not only to balance the bigger gas guzzlers that are still popular in the SUVs that are selling here, but also to prepare them for sale in countries around the world. So things are changing. slowly. AB 32, back in by Arnold Schwarzenegger. You recognize the movie star there. He was interesting to have as a governor. I went through, but the best thing about him, one of the best things, and I consider him a friend, someone who has that kind of media attention, if they're doing it for good purposes, can really change the discussion. I mean, when he can be on the cover of major magazines talking about climate change, whether he's in Europe or Asia, the media follows him. I went with him to a few events in Paris 2 years ago. You go out of the hotel room, and it's just cameras from all over the globe, and he has that message that he can convey to people that don't usually pay attention to climate change is incredibly important. So he signed that bill. We're sitting in San Francisco right then. You can't see San Francisco because it was cold, foggy, and freezing cold with dense fog everywhere. But this was the first multi-sector approach. I mentioned the clean car law. That was tailpipe emissions, mobile emissions. This one went through stationary sources and mobile sources, lower carbon fuels, renewable energy, which is administered by a different agency, appliance and building standards by the CEC, and an emphasis on land use planning as well. Our number one source of emissions in California, which is somewhat unique compared to the other states, is mobile emissions. You can see under transportation, and that means not just changing what comes out of your tailpipe of your cars, but investing in transit. Lower carbon fuels. We now have a requirement that you have to reduce the carbon intensity of fuels by 10%, and the list goes on. But those are where we get our primary sources of greenhouse gas emissions. Climate change legislation wasn't just something for venture capitalists making a lot of money for clean tech in the Silicon Valley. Climate change became really a discussion about linking it to public health outcomes, criteria air pollutants, especially in disadvantaged communities. Look at this picture as far as who are the champions of this policy in 2016. It reflects the diversity of California. This is a real sort of subtle change, but a really important change, because linking these two goals, reducing greenhouse gas emissions plus criteria air pollutants providing the health benefits, were really important so that all communities benefit from these policies. So Eduardo Garcia, the young man standing to the left of Governor Brown, he was the author of AB 197. He's in his 30s. He has now fully embraced all the climate change legislation because it has multiple benefits, not only to his district down in the Coachella Valley, but to health outcomes as well as jobs. We quantify all our emissions. We've had laws that passed. It's really important to start with this premise. You have to measure or you can't manage your emissions. So we've had laws put in place that all major emitters of greenhouse gas emissions have a baseline of how much emissions they're emitting, so we can measure and quantify and enforce their reduction targets through a variety of strategies. We have a long way to go, and Governor Brown, before he leaves office, is determining that we even accelerate where we're going because of the sense of urgency that he has. So with that, I wanted to talk a little bit about sort of lessons learned. I came in, as I said, as a middle school teacher, and I didn't realize the power of the oil companies and special interest groups in California. It's probably good that I didn't, because all the other senior legislators refused to even carry this bill. I thought, you know, it's motherhood and apple pie, cleaning up the air and everything else. And so I realized the environmental message only works for so many legislators. The assembly has 80 members. You need 41 of them to pass this bill in order for it to go to the Senate. So who would be better messengers other than a Sierra Club member from Los Angeles area? I had to reach out from that. And yes, there were environmental groups. But the efforts were behind the scenes. It took a full year to do this, of getting the California Medical Association, the Nurses Association, the Physicians for Social Responsibility, the American Lung Association, all the health organizations in California who had efforts and credibility in areas across the state that I didn't know. So they talked about the importance of climate change and the link to public health outcomes, how on hotter days you have more problems with asthma and allergies and heat problems, especially for children and the elderly. They were incredibly important. We had an interesting group called the Interfaith Council. Sally Bingham, this mild-mannered Episcopalian priest from San Francisco, she had organized, just not in California, but nationally, Christian, Muslim, and Jewish leaders to talk about the moral importance of doing something on climate change and how it affects disproportionately lower-income communities. They would be in the halls of Sacramento talking to their own members from their district. So the rabbi, if you can picture this, or the priest in Sacramento, lobbyists, they're very good lobbyists. One of the hidden secret success stories was this, and I'll tell just a few stories about it. One of the priests for a man who's now in Congress, his name is Juan Vargas, he's from the San Diego area. His priest, he was someone who didn't really want to vote for this bill. I mean, you were going to anger all the oil companies, all the automobile companies. I mean, the list goes on and on. It was on the Chamber of Commerce job killer list. You know, if politically, you had to think about it, right? Well, he was waving. His priest, his family's priest, made a home visit to his house in San Diego with his wife, talking about how important this bill was. He was my 41st vote. So I always think of the valuable role of different messengers and the valuable role of different coalitions that you wouldn't normally put in. We had a new group formed called the Environmental Entrepreneurs. This is the first bill they had ever lobbied on. I didn't know that. I was brand new. I thought they had all this expertise. No, it was a whole bunch of business people, men and women, mostly from the Bay Area, who saw that climate change policies were going to create a market for the future for investment in new technologies. These are sort of the venture capitalist side of it. And solar companies, before they were very prevalent in California. Well, they lobbied on the bill, and they did a great job. Here are men in business suits who are successful talking to legislators about the importance of passing this bill, that this would not hurt the economy. In fact, it would help California meet health outcomes, but also on the economic side as well. When they held press conferences, they got the media's attention, right? The environmental group to some extent, but the business community did play a role, and the health care community played probably the most important role in breaking down the messaging in certain areas of the state that really were affected by health pollution. We also had, of course, only in California would you have Hollywood celebrities engaged. And you guys are probably too young, but one of my favorite stories was Paul Newman, when he was still alive, actually picked up the phone and called female members of the legislature. Well, desperate times call for desperate measures. And word got out that Paul Newman was calling the women in the legislature. And my friends who were already voting for my bill, they said, we're not voting for it anymore until Paul Newman calls us too. So Paul Newman and Robert Redford were very important to the passage of this law, sort of the, you know, Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid revision. All of 2002. There were other players as well. Water agencies, you'd think that's a minor role, but when you have water agencies from around the state talking to legislators about earlier amount of the Sierra snowpack and water availability during the long, hot summers, they're a credible group. Scientists took out full-page ads. Union of Concerned Scientists, but lists of scientists, really, really important. Local cities, local governments, county supervisors in many parts of the state supported this legislation. And what was happening on the college campuses was incredibly helpful. Younger people were starting to get engaged, and with booths up at Earth Day and other things like this. So this was a David versus Goliath kind of fight. We ended up getting it out of the assembly by 41 votes, the bare minimum. We had actually had to lock down everyone in the assembly because the opposition was so strong outside. They were generating 200 or 300 calls an hour into everyone's offices. There were sort of threats against people, not just political threats, but physical threats on voting for this bill. It was a lesson learned on coalition building and messaging that was incredibly, incredibly valuable, that I learned a lot about how you can be effective behind the scenes, calling on sort of a broader consensus of people around California who can talk to different people, different members in different ways in their communities. And the last group that was incredibly important, and maybe not as much today, but there were 12 major daily newspapers in California at the time, you know, from San Diego or the Orange County or LA Times in the Bay Area, 12 of them. And people read newspapers back then. There was no social media, right? But they read newspapers back then. 11 of the 12 newspapers took out editorials in support of this legislation. And why that was helpful is because it shined a light on Sacramento. What happens in Washington, D.C. and Sacramento is that people, if they don't pay attention, you're in this isolated bubble. And you can vote any way you want. Don't have to think about it too much. Maybe you cater too much to special interests, but no one will know. And there's not enough attention. This started having the attention. But the opposition did too. They had commercials running with Worthington. What's his name? Cal Worthington and his dog Spot. On what Sacramento will do. They'll take your car away, force you to drive small cars, and the list went on scare tactics. So it was an all-out fight in the traditional media sense. This is different times. You have to be more sophisticated. But I think the opposition probably with social media gets more interaction than they should because of their ability on both sides to just send out these competing messages that get drowned out somehow in the discussion. So that was my sort of road to victory. But there were three major climate policies, and I wanted to leave you with also the three of them that are being worked on today that are incredibly important. One, we're really trying to make sure that about 50% of all our automobiles sold by 2030 or 2040 are electric vehicles. So putting in the infrastructure, incredibly important. And the legislature did a very smart thing. It was under Senator De Leon's leadership. Who is going to implement all the EV charging stations? The utility companies. Now you've got the utility companies. You have to think about how smart this is. The utility companies, who could have been an opponent, now championing electric cars. Why? They can make some money out of this too. They're selling their energy. So their whole bottom line and ability to be successful in the future is almost guaranteed, because they are going to be competing with the oil companies in the fuel sector, right? Electricity from other. So Edison and San Diego Gas and Electric and Pacific Gas and Electric, that's been a change in dynamics, which has been incredibly helpful as you try to break out the opposition. The other thing we're working on is relating to water. In California, water has a lot to do with energy. 20% of all the energy we use in the state of California is moving, treating, and heating water. We get, most of Southern California gets their water from the Colorado River, 200 miles that way, or 300 miles up in the high Sierras, based on snowpack that may or may not be there. We transport it long distances up and over mountains. Now, though, we're going to be using water not just once, but two or three times. We recycle water, use it on landscaping. We're using now treated wastewater for potable drinking water in places like Irvine. Those of you who live in Irvine, if you didn't know that, you do now. And it's not that controversial. It's proven that it'd be cleaned up to the extent. But every time you reuse water or desalination, right? You're taking the salt out of water, uses very energy intensive processes. You are increasing energy. So we've done some studies that show if we don't figure out how to incorporate more renewables or conserve water better, or maybe not export as much or import as much from Northern California, the amount of energy we use on water is not going to be 20%, it could be 30% or more. We're going in the wrong direction. So the water fix is needed on that. And the last comment that we're really need to work on is ramping up lower carbon fuels. It's always been the goal of the oil companies to get rid of that component of our policies to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. They could make lower carbon fuels. They choose not to. They choose to fight us at the moment. There are biofuel companies that are becoming successful, but they need a market. They can make the fuels. That's not the problem. Who's buying the fuels? That is the problem. So United Airlines reached an agreement with Paramount, biofuel company, which is near Long Beach, and they're buying a large amount of lower carbon fuels for aviation purposes from this one company who can now double their expansion and hire people and everything else. So it's a catch-22 there. The market is needed. The market signals are needed that lower carbon fuels will be a wave of the future and will not be subject to opposition by oil companies. We're always worried with the cap and trade discussion that that's on the table, getting rid of the lower carbon fuel standard. And with that, the future is yours. I think your conference is just a marvelous example of what needs to be done, right? You work with other cities, you're working with other countries, can't be better than that. And so thank you very much for allowing me to spend some time with you.